Hey, here we are. Guys, we are back. I'm starting to like this song, I gotta say. I'm gonna turn it down a little bit. Sean Murray, this song, Sean Murray from a Reason Plus sound pack called Fresh Drum and Bass. It's good. I have already, and thank you, Sean, I have already used that sort of progressive house synth, the sort of almost dead mousey type of pulsing synth. I've used that as well. People are saying hi, David. Hi, David. Hi, Kilsane. How's it going? Jordan Scott, love the live streams. We love doing them, so I'm stoked to have you guys here. Well, listen, how is everybody doing? I hope everybody had a good week. This season two of the live stream, I have to say, is a little, in some ways, it's more publicized in terms of, as compared to when we first did the live stream back in 2020, we were really kind of like planning, like after we would finish a live stream on a Tuesday, on Wednesday, we go, what are we doing next week? Ugh, you know, it was real like seat of our pants kind of planning. This time we planned out the whole live stream. And we originally thought we'd be doing this sort of every 2 weeks. And now we're starting to do some of these, like, you know, we were here last week and now we're back. And so it's been fun to kind of play around with a little more looseness on the schedule, but a little more rigidity in terms of you guys knowing who's coming up when and what to expect. A comment I got from someone on a video, they were asking about the Toro y Moi live stream that we are doing and the interview that we did. I'll just explain that quickly for people as they're kind of jumping onto the stream here. Toro y Moi is booked as a guest on the live stream. We've actually already recorded, because of logistics, we already recorded the interview with him. And so we're going to be doing a debut replay live stream post view. I don't know what you want to call it. But basically, I'm going to be streaming the interview I did with him to you guys live, and we'll be sort of commenting and watching it and maybe even pausing, and we'll kind of chat about it, the me version of live, and then we'll go back to playing the me and Toro y Moi version of the replay. So that's going to be coming up here. But good to see you guys showing up here. Jose Gabriel Ligueras, hello. I'll give you a real IRL wave for your emoji wave here. So listen, before we bring Jeremy on here, I'm just going to give you guys a little update on the week since we last were here. We had Sarah as our guest last Monday, and then as soon as I was done that, I shot down the 5 freeway from San Francisco down to Los Angeles, and I spent the week in Los Angeles with James, who's the head of content over at Reason Studios in Stockholm. He flew out to Los Angeles, and him and I kind of hung out for the whole week with some producers. I won't say who, but some cool people. We shot some artist feature interviews that we're going to be putting together and putting out. We did a live event with BPM Supreme, where at their facility, they've got an awesome office in Los Angeles, right in Hollywood, and they've got this wonderful office with a big space where they do live events. And so they had my guy Mars, who is a big time. If you guys, you probably know, I don't have to give you his credits, but we're, you know, we're talking Nipsey Hussle and Snoop and just major, major producer in hip hop. And he gave a workshop about how he uses Reason and kind of how he makes beats. And it was a workshop sort of showing his workflow along with the way that he uses BPM Create, which is the sample library service that BPM Supreme runs as well. And so he was sort of showing how he grabs samples off of BPM Create, brings him into Reason, and then he made a few beats live. So it was great. James is in the chat saying, excellent LA hangs, Ryan. I agree. James and I had a good time. You know, James and I have worked together for years. This is the weird thing about the pandemic, is that we have worked together for years, and we just met for the first time in person. So that's weird, but good to know that we get along just as well as we do on Slack when we're typing. No, we've talked before, of course. Anyway, so let's kind of get down to business here. Looks like people are getting in here. So I'm going to bring on our guest here and chat with him. I'm really excited to have Jeremy Lloyd as our guest today. We're going to talk about some of the stuff he's done, some stuff that you guarantee you know, and we're going to take a look at that, and some stuff, some new stuff that's been he's been working on as well. So we're going to do all of the above, and with that, let's do it. Jeremy, say hello to the internet. You have arrived.
Hello. Thanks so much for having me.
Well, thank you very much. So listen, first of all, welcome to the Reason Livestream. When yesterday Jeremy and I set up his tech, I held off telling you, Jeremy, until the live stream here, that you and I grew up unwittingly as neighbors. So I grew up in Broomall, which is just across the way from your old stomping grounds, you know.
Definitely.
Our high school teams probably played each other. We might have been bowling at Wynwood Lanes at the same time. Who knows, you know? So.
Wow.
Yeah. But you're not in Philadelphia now, right? You've since moved on.
In Brooklyn.
Gotcha.
My parents still live in Philly, and I go back there from time to time, but Brooklyn's been my home since like 2013.
Is that right? Gotcha. Without dating myself, I think we are of a slightly different era of Philadelphia. I think I was there a little bit before you, but my understanding, I haven't lived there since I was 18, maybe 19. But when I was there, it was still 90s, you know, late 90s. And Philadelphia was always regarded as like a somewhat of a stagnant music town, in that it was like cover bands and, you know, like if you were going to be a musician in Philadelphia, you were playing wedding gigs and you were doing cover shows and you were playing sort of like classic rock, and that was sort of it. And then my sense after I moved away is like all this stuff happened. Like, you know, I mean, yourself, obviously, you know, Marian Hill, Christina Perry, I think, came out of Philadelphia as well. Like, mm-hmm. There's a lot of like, I sort of thought, was like, where was this Philadelphia when I was growing up there, you know?
I always have been someone who credits the internet music scene for how I came up a lot more than any tangible real world music scene, for better or for worse. A lot of my time when I was in Philly, I was in high school, and occasionally I would do an open mic with a friend, but like most of the time I was kind of just making music in my bedroom. And a lot of when things started to connect for me was when I was like in my last years of college or my first year moving to New York, and just kind of sending my music out to blogs in the heyday of the blog era. So I always credit that like hype machine in 2012-2013 scene as the real scene that I came up in, more so than any physical place.
That makes sense. Hey, a quick just technical note. Some people are saying they'd like us to turn your mic up. Could we go to System Preferences and just max
for
it
sure.
out? Max your mic out entirely.
Can
and guys,
do.
What I'll do too is I'll pull my mic down a little bit, and then you can sort of equalize.
Right, of course. If someone comes up with a easy little compressor for these things.
Oh my God, wouldn't it be?
The amount of Zooms I've been on where I'm just like, oh man, you're one person or too loud. That's so weird. We turned this up yesterday and it's back down again.
Is it back down? Okay.
Now it's back up.
Okay,
so
cool.
I should be louder.
I'll
keep that open in case there's an issue.
Perfect. Significantly
if it's
louder.
Too loud, let me know too. I can bring it back.
Okay, cool. I think everyone will be pleased with that. We just got a nice little volume bump there. Cool. So yeah, so what you were sort of saying, this is sort of the advent of the global internet influence sort of changes the scene from being, it's not a local scene anymore. It is a scene can develop online, influences can develop online and stuff like that. So what was your, to speak maybe to Marian Hill as your musical kind of first act, if we will, what was the sort of influence that drove the sound of, and drives the sound of Marian Hill?
Let's see. I would say there's a good portion of it that was just happenstance and good luck. There's like a good portion of it that was, I at that time was about to graduate college, had been, as I was telling you on the live stream, Reason had added audio that year, and Reason was the audio software I'd been comfortable with. So it just was like, Reason basically invited me to start making songs with my friends who were vocalists with that feature edition. And I was trying out a bunch of different things. At the time, I was really influenced by everything that was on Hype Machine. And I remember there were also a lot of duos happening at the time. We had a Luna George who had come up with their first, like, Your Drums, Your Love was maybe like 6 months before Marian Hill. there was Purity Ring, there was churches, there was Sylvanesso.
Right.
There was a lot of this happening, and it was exciting to me because I was someone who had been kind of going back and forth on, like, well, I don't feel like I would be just like a solo artist. Like, that doesn't feel like what I want to do. But I also love the idea of being able to still be an artist and, like, shape a sound and not be, like, the second fiddle to someone at the time. I was like, I want my own artistic agency. So all that to be said, like, that scene at the time that was happening on Hype Machine and on blogs made me be like, let me try this. Let me see if I can find something that works for this. And then I made a bunch of different things. There was a song I made with one of my friends from college, and we called our band Puddle, and it was like a pretty wavy, more like James Blake adjacent type of thing with him on vocals. And then I made two different songs with Sam. One of them was a little more like jangly and sample based, and then the other one was Whiskey. And Whiskey was just, I'd made a beat I really liked that felt like a hip-hop beat to me. I kind of played it offhand when I was showing Sam some stuff, but it wasn't something I thought, like, hey, she should sing on this. This would be cool. But when she did, it was really, really cool. And everyone liked it more than anything I'd done. Huh. And it was a very crystallizing moment in that I always say that, like, I stumbled into producing that song and then was like, whoa, this really worked. People really like this. How did I do that? Like, what was happening?
Interesting.
There? And it became, from that point, kind of a diving more into, like, what was connecting with people on that, leaning into the minimalism, getting to know Sam better, leaning into emphasizing her voice in the best ways, and the sound kind of emerged from there. But it was really, we were fortunate to be in a situation at the time where I emailed Whiskey to, like, 20 or 30 Hype Machine blogs that I'd researched with, like, a little personal note, and, like, three or four of them posted it the next day. It was getting played on WXBN, local Philly radio, the next day.
Yeah, 88.5 FM, hey.
And yeah, before we knew it, people were like, yeah, we need more music. And it was really cool to be able to have that kind of test case and be like, okay, people want this, let's make more.
Wow.
But that's how the sound came about.
That is really interesting. And on the one hand, so I think it's interesting that you made made something with sort of a certain intent. I mean, you said, I'm sort of making a hip-hop beat, and then obviously she took it in not a,
yeah,
you know, it took it out of that context. It's sort of like a, you know, there's a suggestion and then a sort of a call and response almost, if
exactly
you will, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah. And yeah, the other thing I find interesting about that too is what you said about it got traction, and that causes you to, like, when you're making it, you're making it for yourself. You're just trying something out and seeing what happens. The minute it gets traction, it is near impossible to not have, now there's three people involved in the making of this. There is you, Sam, and then the self-awareness of the people that have responded to it. And how do we, how do we do that again for them? You know, how do we, whatever, what made that happen? You know, and that's got to be almost, I guess in some ways intimidating, right?
A little bit. There was definitely, you know, there's like a 6-month period where people were like, yeah, we want more songs. When are you going to play live? And we were like, wow, we have 1.5 songs. And I guess we can work on some covers, but that doesn't really feel like a live show. I think we need to have some more music as we figure that out.
That sounds like my band's first gig at a local pool where we played, we had like 4 or 5 songs and we just played them like multiple, we just kept doing this set in a loop, you know?
Yeah, it's hard. It's so funny now because we go to put together a set and we're just like, oh, man, we can barely do anything, I guess,
if we want to keep
it to an hour. Back in that time, it was very much, there was definitely pressure around that. But I do think it was cool to have that pressure with also the knowledge that there were people excited about it and waiting for it. I think it can be tough to be in a position where you're just like trying to write stuff that people will care about. And to be able to be like, people care about what we're going to do, how do we follow this up, just felt like a step further from that to make things just a little more motivated and a little more like, well, we'll have their attention at least.
Right. There is, I liked, you said something about kind of wanting to be an artist, you know, and wanting to find, that you were in some ways searching for a way to sort of have... artistic public you know, face. You weren't wanting to just be this guy in the background. There is a term, I've always hated it, and there's a term, and it sounds like you guys could have been victim to that term had you not sort of made those very active choices of being one of the artists. It's a phrase that comes out of the UK. They refer to certain acts as the bird and the nerd, referring to, like, you know,
the bird and the bee. Is that coming from that?
No. Like, so the bird in the UK in the vernacular, bird is sort of like.
No, I just I'm talking about the duo, the bird and the bee.
Oh yeah, maybe.
I'm wondering if it comes from that.
Because, I wonder if it is. Yeah. But I've
Greg Kirsten is doing quite well.
Yeah, exactly. And I've always hated the phrase because I always feel like it slags off both sides of that equation. You know, it diminishes the technical contribution of someone that they might deem to be less involved, and it minimizes the artistic contribution of the other half. I mean, it's always bugged me. And so you're...
Yeah, well, there's so many assumptions people make, even with, you know, a pop star. They assume, they're like, who are the producers she's working with?
Right.
That are, like, giving her this sound. And I feel like pretty much always it's not that simple.
Never, right.
Like, pretty much always, like, I know in our case, like, Sam had to love what we did and in order for it to be final. And
right.
And that was about, like, both of us coming to a place based on both of our skills. But...
Absolutely.
Yeah, I feel like it's very rarely like producer shows up with like the full song and is like, and now sing it.
Yeah, exactly.
Like that's very old timey and like super rare these days, especially with like collaborative duos like we are.
Certainly. So when was the point when you guys sort of realized, you know, there's that things are starting to get traction, you're doing more songs, but when was the point when you sort of realized like, oh, maybe we have arrived is a cliche phrase, but sort of when is that moment when you kind of go like, oh, we're not trying to like desperately like get enough material and push ourselves out there. We are out there. People are starting to really respond on a bigger scale than even the previous sort of early traction.
Yeah, I mean, I think there was a moment in, let me see if I can get the year right of this. I think there was a moment in like October 2015 or 2014 actually, through like January 2015, where several different little things broke our way and things started to become real. We had, this was the early days of Vine, and one of our songs one time was in this Leonardo DiCaprio in Titanic Vine. I always like to joke that like a solid number of like young girls discovered that Leonardo DiCaprio used to be dreamy to our music, but it was a real sensation. It was getting, and this was the end of iTunes, but we still like, we saw a fair amount of iTunes sales off of this Vine. And I remember like going into our TuneCore account with Sam and being like, oh my God, like there's money in here.
Well, you know,
we at that point we took our parents out to dinner, and like soon after that we were starting to have more serious conversations with labels, and we signed in January, and things were kind of coalescing, and then we were in a Taco Bell commercial, and all these things started to just line up and like display like, yes, that thing that it was a thing you were testing out. And you were like, we got to make more. Like, now it's, like, connecting on a broader scale, and it seems like you're going to be able to do this.
Interesting. You know, so when that moment happens, the Vine sort of thing, do you know that's happening? Or is it like, because if I go back earlier, and I'm going to go pre-Vine, I had a experience not on the same scale, but an experience like that where a song with a music duo that I was part of went... it got regular rotation suddenly on Sirius. We didn't know this yet, but it was got picked up by Sirius. It was being, you know, on a few of their channels, getting regular rotation, caused a bump in iTunes sales. And so we all of a sudden we were just like, we were used to getting our little, you know, pittance things. And all of a sudden we're like, wait, what happened last month? Something happened. And we had to sort of go out and try and figure it out. Was that still that way with Vine? You had to be like, where's this coming from?
I think we knew from Twitter, if I remember right.
Yeah,
I think it probably not right away, but at some point the commentary about the Vine showed up on Twitter, and we were like, "What is this?" And
then
we dug in more and were able to kind of find it and see. But
well, it's no surprise.
It was a crazy time.
No surprise that TikTok now is really kind of moving into the music distribution space in a big way. And I think if anyone watching out there, you should, hearing this story and kind of seeing the effect that you know, Vine and TikTok being the kind of the next iteration of Vine can have on your music, they should look into what TikTok just announced, I think, last week with their music distro, getting your music into TikToks. So, well, okay, so now... I will say that the way I became aware of you, and I think maybe a lot of people became aware of you, was when you guys caught the attention of Apple. Was Steve? No, Steve Jobs wasn't still with us at that point. So yeah, so Apple in general, not him personally. But what can you tell us about just kind of that experience of like you get a
yeah. So I mean we. So in our first few years, well, after we signed, there were definitely a lot of syncs that came in. I think we at the time had a pretty new and unique sound, and various, as I mentioned, Taco Bell movie trailers. There were like a few other things where people were like, "Ooh, like let's use this." And I remember, I forget how the original. I had through like a friend of a friend. Had gotten a path to someone at Apple and like sent over some music, and they were interested in our song Lips, which came out before even our debut album, but it was on our first EP and came out around that time I was talking about in October 2014. And they were very interested in it, and that was a great boost for us. And then nothing ended up happening, and you know, with sync, a lot of the time you're like hearing you're up for this, and then
right.
That's the end. And then after the album was out, like a similar thing happened with Down, where like we knew they were interested, and then we heard like, well, they think it's happening, but it was like very hush hush because they were like, it would be a big thing, and like our label was excited, and I just remember personally being like, we'll see if it actually happens. Yeah. Like this sounds cool, but who knows? And yeah, then it actually happened, and things started moving pretty fast from there. They like. Premiered it during like the NFL playoffs, I think. And like we were pretty like instantly the song was like in the top on Shazam,
right?
And I think we, even before doing anything, like within a few weeks it was starting to get radio play, and then it was just a matter of our label like pushing on it more.
I mean,
but I know for me it was such a gratifying experience, because I've always been someone who felt like, man, if a bunch of people just heard our music, I think they'd really like it. And this was such a like testament to that. It was just like, our song is getting played in living rooms around the country, and people are like, what's that? Can I listen to that? I think it's definitely a really cool moment.
For anyone who's maybe younger than 25, they might not fully appreciate, but they might have some sense. But like, in the era of, I mean, what are we, maybe 2000, I'll go with 2003 or 4 until, well, we could say present day, but maybe I'll go as far as 2018 or something. Like, there's this era where Apple product launch commercials was almost like a platform unto itself in terms of recognition, you know, and there's no shortage of examples of artists that broke because of those, you know, sort of being... Yeah, just suddenly lifted up to this like platform where all your eyes are on your music. But in a way that what I think was always so interesting about every time it was done was this really wonderful, and I do credit, I think, sort of the Steve Jobs era with this, that they really, it was like a really lovely symbiosis where they were obviously co-opting your music to make their product cool, but their product was cool, and so it kind of like lifted your, kind of gave your music like a little bit of this lift into like your music became the soundtrack of this cool thing, you know, and it really had I think a fascinating thing. And for your, am I correct that you were used on the AirPod launch campaign? So this new thing that we now all see people walking around with was launched via Down. Is that true?
Sorry, what was launched via Down?
The AirPods was, it was,
yes,
the launch,
the AirPods.
It was the launcher. It wasn't like, oh, the new updated version of AirPods. It was like,
no, yeah, it was like, this is our new tech. And Like, Lil Buck was dancing to our song wearing the AirPods for the first time. I also remember, like, our name and our album art was in the commercial. Like,
yes, yes.
A little thing like that can, like, really go a long way. And, at the end of the commercial, like, you see Lil Buck's iPhone, and it's, like... And I think he even says earlier in the commercial in some of the edits, play Marian Hill.
Yes, like, right.
There's some really nice, subtle stuff that most commercials just don't emphasize.
Absolutely.
You know, most commercials are going to use your song, but they're not going to, like, advertise your song. So we were, like, super lucky in the way that the commercial both used our song and was like, and this is the band Marian Hill, check them out.
Right. It's the benefit of them also in that same time really trying to push their music streaming service, whereas, you know, Coca-Cola would not, you know, go through such lengths.
Right, they would not care.
And then you're just at the mercy of people Googling what song in Coke commercial, you know, with Dancer or whatever, you know. And still a lot of people would get to you, but you're right, that is like just a whole nother level. Well, since we're talking about it, maybe could we briefly take a look at the Down session, because I know this was done entirely in Reason. I mean, right? It was.
Yep.
It's not like it was stemmed into Reason or something. Let's take a little look here at it. You've told me this is a almost deceptively simple.
Especially I was laughing looking back at this. This is before Reason had VSTs. So we are really, like, my delay compensation is 176. Like, the main piano in this song is just an ID8 with, like,
wow,
hardly, like a filter on it that I automate. But, like, otherwise, very, very simple stuff. Vocal here. I haven't used this chain on Sam in a while, but this was the chain we used for much of the first stuff. It's just an RV7.
Wow.
And all the drums are in Kong.
These are really simple devices. That RV7, you got into Reason. Do you know what version you sort of got into Reason?
I do. In high school, bought an MBox 2 with money I'd saved up, and it came with Pro Tools 7 and Reason 3.5.
Wow. So I think the RV7000, the more, I guess, if you will, advanced version of the reverb, was still there. But you still liked what sort of the digitalness of the RV7, or what is your gravitation there? The simplicity of it?
I think I was. The simplicity. I think at the time, like, I was kind of intimidated by all the options on the 7000, and I, you know, as I was learning as I went, just felt a lot more comfortable with these kind of four knobs in the hall setting, and
didn't even really want to go.
Like, there's hardly any of it either. I basically took the reverb that I used on our vocal in Whiskey and kept that constant for a while.
Gotcha. I'm looking at the compressor. I sort of love the compressor, and I don't say this with anything other than admiration for the "if it works, it works" sort of approach. That's the default settings for the compressor. There's no, you know, you just loaded it.
Oh, it looks like look at that though. Look at that. Not quite default.
Oh. Right. Just driving that thing just a little harder. That's right.
Yeah. But truly, I like, especially in the first year of Marian Hill, like, I was very much learning how to produce as it happened. I joke that Whiskey was the best song I'd ever produced by, like, a significant margin.
Yeah.
And I spent a lot of the next year or so just, like, trying to actually get good so I could do that more than once.
Interesting.
That time, I was very conscious of how our sound was unique and trying to keep that going.
Yeah.
And one of those areas was, I was like, people are liking Sam's voice simple. This is how I did it on Whiskey, and I'm not going to overcomplicate things.
Totally makes sense.
And now I use a lot more on vocal chains, and I'm more familiar with compressors and all this stuff. But at the time, I was just like, if I don't touch it too much, it should sound good.
Yeah. Her voice, it does. It sounds great. Do you happen to remember what mic you would have been using on that, just for the folks keeping score at home?
I'm trying to remember the numbers for it, but I know that it was Sterling Audio. It was one of those Guitar Center mics.
Yes, I remember those. Okay. So, but it was kind of a, you know, a large diaphragm condenser.
Large diaphragm condenser, yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. Cool. Is that the, am I hearing the lovely tones of the subway?
Lovely tones of New York City. one thing I was also talking about with you about this session that I think is interesting.
Yeah.
This was the first album that we worked with someone else to mix, and I worked with Tony Maserati, who I was very lucky to be able to work with and spend a lot of time working on the record with and learning from.
Right.
We spent so much time because I had bounced out the individual drum stems and they just were not sounding right. Mm. Like, it just was not hitting like my version did, and it was very frustrating. And we went through a ton of different steps, and what we ended up doing is just bouncing the whole drums through the Reason master compressor so that he loaded that audio file up in his mix. And as you can see, it's really slamming it, but it sounds just so good, and I needed it.
Let's take a little listen. Yeah.
Mix. But you know, it's really slamming it on those kick hits, but it's also just like really gluing it in a way that I really love.
I think it's a wonderful example of the rule is the rule until you break it and it's better than the rule, and now that's okay too, you know. Because if you were to go, you know, if you were to take an audio engineering course and they were teaching you about the, you know, SSL's original master bus compressor and how to use it and stuff, the sure general rule for a glue compressor is that you just get the needle excited, but you don't really, it's not, mm-hmm. you know, a compressor. It's more just meant to kind of like, I mean, that's kind of where the glue nature of it.
Soften the edges.
Yeah, just soften the edges and kind of give everything kind of this, when you put it on the master bus, you're giving all sounds the same cohesive kind of dynamic response, but it's relatively subtle. And I've seen a couple other people do this. You're one of them. Motion Worker, another artist we've talked to, is one of them, where they slam the master bus compressor and it's the attitude is like, and it sounds good, right? And you have to go, yeah, it sounds really good. And they go, okay, so what, I don't want to hear about your little exciting the needle, like, I'm just, it's just the way it is.
Yeah,
and it's a great example of it. It sounds really good. In fact, I wonder if people would be able to hear if you were to change the threshold of the master bus there until so it's not actually active. I wonder if we'd actually be able
to. I could just switch it on and off too.
Oh yeah, yeah, sure, 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 sure. Yeah.
It's like in the attack.
It's in the attack. I hope people can hear it at home. It's subtle, especially coming over the internet and probably then going out over YouTube. So God knows how it makes it. But yes, it's in the attack, particularly the kick drum in the attack there, that you really feel. You feel the pulse. I mean, that pattern on that kick drum is so much part of the pulse of the song. In fact, I guess if we're being really broad strokes about it, the song, what makes that part of the song work is the interplay between the kick drum and the sampled, you know, down to down down da 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 da, you know. So
yeah. And as a last thing I can show in this session would be that part you were just singing. The chop is composed of two foundational Reason instruments, the NNXT, which I have just like the same chain that I have on her vocal.
Uh-huh.
And her saying down, and then I can play it on the keyboard.
Oh yeah, there.
and then for the Are You Down, I was saying to you, I'm so grateful for Mimic, because in this instance I chopped this up in Recycle and then loaded it up in Dr. Octorex. But you get the
Are you down?
And playing that in here again, just going through the same chain as
right.
Your vocal.
So yeah. So were you doing this song in? It would be two different mimics, probably in 2022, if you were to be doing the song, right?
Certainly.
So those two ones. I guess they're the NNXT one. Just by the nature of NNXT, it doesn't do any kind of like smart transposing, if you will. Like when you transpose a sound, you get the shifted formats, the chipmunk effect, you know. That in your case was the reality. You had no other option, but it's also sounds great. But what was the chicken and the egg there? Did you sort of go, oh, I'm going to pitch it and I know it's going to kind of chipmunk and that's going to be cool? Or did you pitch it and go, oh, hey, that chipmunk thing is cool? Does that make sense?
So, I mean, I think at this point, especially early on, the NXT was a big part of my workflow in that I would just drag a sample into it and see what it sounded like. Like I was very into like stuff like that. And like on, I think this might even be, no, it's a different sample, but like Got It, there's a similar just like instrument that it's just a vocal sample in an NXT. Wow.
that's like the rubber baby buggy bumper of Reason Tech Talk.
But I think I remember in this instance hearing the melody in my head for what that part could be, the da 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 da. And then I was just like, I could either chop this by hand or just drag it in there and play it. And I think I'll drag it in there and play it.
Perfect. Perfect. Well, the chops, I mean, you know, we're comments coming in, you know, those chops are legendary. I think they really are. I mean, one of the things about the song is like, it's so minimalistic in its construction that every part is kind of like, I mean, iconic is a little bit of a huge word to use here, but you could play those chops in isolation and everyone knows what song you're talking about. You could play that piano part in isolation and everyone knows what song you're talking about. Like each part stands on its own as an instantly recognizable element of the song. That's no small feat to have achieved, I think.
Thank you. Yeah, I really take pride in trying to, especially with Marian Hill stuff, make songs where you can hear every element, and every element is good. And there is no, like, stacking of things and, like, getting lost in instruments and being like, is that a... Like, you're always just like, that's a hat, that's a snare, that's a kick, that's a chop, that's a piano, like, that's a vocal. Like, there's nothing hidden.
Because that's a very mature, developed sense of production, and you seem to have come to it almost... first. It doesn't you know, you don't look at your musical catalog and go, oh yeah, it took him a while but he finally learned that lesson. Like, you kind of came into it just knowing that.
I think it's truly like what I was saying earlier about how we stumbled onto Whiskey. Like, it was very much like I was trying things that were more maximalist and more conventional, and Whiskey was just the first thing that really caught on and felt special. And that was how the production in Whiskey worked. Whiskey was like super simple, super sparse.
Right.
And it just, I liked the idea of it, and I also think, especially early on, it's what made my production unique and what enabled me to be making well-produced music while not being super experienced in the minutia of producing. Like, so often in that era, I would try to emulate something and end up with something very unique that wasn't like what I was trying to emulate because I wasn't good enough to emulate it, but I had still wound up with something that felt unique and special and like me because I was doing it in the only way I knew.
Right. One last thing about the song, and then we'll jump off it because we got some other stuff to look at. But I'm just curious of the origins of sort of the song and the hook as, or the sort of the titular down, if you will. Did that come from Sam's? She wrote a top line, and you then sort of from there were like, ooh, I'll rex that, and then from there, ooh, I can transpose that, and then ooh, that's the hook.
So this was definitely a song that came together very fast. I think we did some tweaks in later sessions, but most of it really happened in the first session. And I always think it's funny because, like, for a while in this time, I would have an IDE8 just loaded up when I, in my kind of like blank template, when I opened up a new session, because I'd be like, let's just have like something to know what key we're in. And I was just noodling around and started playing the riff. And Sam, I think, soon after started singing some of those ideas, and then everything started coming together pretty fast.
I see.
But it's just the IDE8. It's really funny.
You know, something I'm noticing, though. Oh, go ahead.
Yeah.
Oh, so something I'm noticing in your, if you scroll up there, it looks like you, in your template maybe, had three IDAs, piano right, piano center, and piano left. What's that about it? Because it, now I'm realizing this is a rather wide sound, but that's not a single IDA. It's actually two IDAs.
Yeah, I think, you know, again, I these days I might use track spacer or something, but at that time I was like, feels like when the piano's centered, we're like losing the vocal a bit. And I think especially when the beat came in, also I was kind of losing the piano a bit. Mm-hmm. And so by panning the piano hard left and hard right, having just basically one of those in each ear, made it so that when the full drums and everything were in and the chops were happening, we were still able to hear the piano with clarity, but it wasn't getting in the way of the drums being big. So yeah, just
gotcha.
Just some mixing by panning, but yeah, you can hear it's.
You know we could put 'em on.
Where is it?
Right.
Like it has its own place there.
You really feel it, yeah. That you've got room for the center sort of sample hook, the chop, and that piano is kind of hugging it on all sides.
Exactly.
You know? Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, that is cool. Well, cool. Okay, so. That's the one that anyone who wears a pair of AirPods certainly knows. But you are a Reason user and have been from before the song and since the song, and you, I imagine, have some little I don't know, tips and tricks that we could probably all learn from.
Yeah, well, I have three albums that I executive produced that all came out in the last like 2.5 months.
Right.
First one is the new Marian Hill album, but then I also last month did my first ever solo album as Clear Eyes, which has been this really fun kind of back burner project for several years that is finally getting its place in the sun. And then also I was able to, during the pandemic, remotely form a really great relationship with this artist Rio Cragen, and executive produced his album and even did some mixes and masters all using my lovely Reason ecosystem. So I thought it would be fun to dip into each of those worlds after spending some time in the Marian Hill world.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's great. And the Clear Eyes stuff, by the way, if people haven't listened to it, it is fantastic, number one. But I think it's also, I always love with artists, when I like an artist that's part of sort of a collaborative artistry, I love when they do solo work, because then I can start sort of trying to glean, you know, like, what is the, I mean, we'll take the always obvious example of like listening to the John Lennon and Paul McCartney solo material, and then you go back to the Beatles and you kind of understand what their contributions were in the context of the collaborative environment. So anyone who hasn't checked out Clear Eyes yet, it's great music on a recreational listen. It's also really informative, I think, on a sort of academic level, if that makes sense.
Or a producer.
You know what I mean? Like we, as producers, we sort of listen to each other and try and like see what makes us all tick. And so I think it's kind of cool.
So let's see. There's a bunch of stuff going on in this one. This is Up to Me featuring Rasheen Marie. It's a song I really love. And I'm trying to see what would be fun to dive into first. So the
one
big thing that I wanted
one thing
to
that
highlight
jumps out
was
to me.
The,
sorry to interrupt you. One thing that jumps out to me right away is that, as compared to sort of the simplicity of Down, is we got a lot more tracks here, a lot more regions, a lot more automation. Yep. I think, you know, like stuff's happening.
Yep. Love me some automation, and I love in Reason being able to see all my automation whenever I'm in Ableton. I feel like you can get kind of lost and be like, what is doing that, and have to kind of hunt around. And
oh right,
something nice about being in Reason and just scrolling and like, if there's automation, I'm gonna see it and I'll deal with it.
Right.
But yeah, I think for this one, a lot of the coolest stuff that I do is happening on this drop section. So I'll give us a little lead into it, and then we can dig into specifically the sub that I created for it, which I talked a little bit about on Instagram, but which is all Reason stuff for the most part, and then having some particle fun down here with Proton. So yeah.
But I know someone else could love you better. And everything.
So, cool. I love this bass sound a lot.
Yeah.
And it's become a staple of a lot of things, and you'll notice it's called Friction Sub.
Friction Sub.
And that's because it's started with friction.
Wow.
So I think, yeah, we can walk through this, but
initialized patch that has the hallmarks of from the ground up sound design project of yours, I guess.
Yep. I mean, I especially with a string plugin like this, I always just like to start messing around and turning all the knobs and going through things and seeing what it can really do. Yeah, I was playing with this.
Wow.
So there's kind of our foundational sound there. And sometimes I'll mess with the articulation a bit, but there was something about the resonance of the banjo in here and then doing the pluck, and I love this call lengo setting, like the kind of interesting attack you can get from it.
And Collegno, for people that don't speak Spanish, Italian, and arrange for strings often, it's the technique of actually sort of smacking the string rather than plucking it or bowing it. You're actually using the bow to whack the string, and it does have a really kind of neat attack envelope, yeah.
So then after that, I'm doing some mild EQing with Pro-Q, which is... This is a funny issue. What do you guys think about this?
Oh,
this happens to me sometimes.
Oh, no.
It's like just when I drag it between monitors, it does that, and then I close it and reopen it, and it's fine. But yeah, this is very slight, but I'm just kind of taking off some of the higher stuff.
Yeah. That's more like almost just as a like mix maintenance, pre-mixing maintenance of like just rolling off that high end, yeah.
And then, of course, Polar, which is, as I think I told you, one of my just like favorite pitch shifting tools. There's something very smooth about the way it processes it. I do smooth mode and I turn the analysis type to fast. And then we brought the shifter all the way down 24.
Okay.
All of a sudden, we've got a sound like this.
Wow.
And there's just something about the resonance you get from that when it's, you know, starting high and getting pitched down that really, I don't know, I just loved this kind of, it's like a little lazy because of all the processing, and it's like just so rich.
Is it possible I'd love to maybe hear, so instead of using Polar, you could have just played two octave lower, but you would have gotten a different it would have gotten a different result.
Yeah, let's try it. I'll take Polar off, and I will, and now here's my feature request coming up.
That's right.
I really want to be able to go right here.
That's
and
right,
just transpose.
You hear that, Stockholm? Jeremy loves that you can select audio clips and transpose right there in the in the top bar. But MIDI, you can't. Put it in there, guys. For Jeremy, if nobody else. And I'll tell you what, I'll second the motion if I...
It sounds like two octaves low. It doesn't...
Oh,
it
won't even go there.
There,
of course, right? Because that's
but I think,
outside
can I,
the range
I
could of...
Can I do...
No, I think...
Can I extend the range? It doesn't seem like I can.
I don't think you... I think maybe not for... What instrument is... No, I don't know. I guess not, because that would go take it down.
Yeah, I think
to,
the banjo runs out.
Yeah,
I can move it up an octave to see just like
yeah,
what
I guess
one
move it up an octave. Yeah,
sounds like
that gets into the. There you go. It's got a lot more of the what. So what Polar is doing, and in fact, in order to get it back to your sound, use undo so that because when we were down two octaves, we were probably sending friction a bunch of key switching messages.
Oh, good point.
But what Polar was doing is it's rounding off the edges of the Collegno, you know, so the Collegno's still there, but it's now as a result of Polar's pitch shift algorithm, it sort of, it gets funkier in a good way, you know?
I'm just trying to undo to it. There we go. Come on.
There we go. Okay. It's so cool.
Yeah, it's just so, it's really smooth. And sometimes you, like, when you want to pitch stuff, like, sometimes I'm looking for a more intense character, and then I'll, like, do auto trans, I'll, like, use the Reason built in, like, click audio and transpose it, or I'll put it through Alter Boy if I really want it to get funky and there's some character ideas I have. Right. When I want it to be smooth and, like, non-abrasive, like, Polar is really nice. And Polar also can do great things with polyphony, or polyphony, which, you know, Alter Boy can't really handle. And as I'll show in another song, like, there's a piano that it might even be in here, but there's a piano where I do a similar thing.
Polar is a little bit of a dark horse in the Reason devices. I think it was one of the first rack extensions that ever came out. And as a result of the sort of, you know, new shiny object bias that happens with all of us, I think some people may have forgotten just how cool it can be in sort of imparting this kind of sound design element to your songs.
I mean, I think that one of the kind of things that differentiates different DAWs from each other is the pitch shifting algorithms, and, like, the different ways you can get things to sound when you pitch them around. And this is, I think I see Polar as, like, one of the unique tools that I get because I use Reason that other people don't have. And I find very often people will be listening to my track and they'll be like, ooh, that sounds, like, really cool how you pitched that. Like, how did you do that? And I'm just like, sorry, it's Polar. You can get the Reason VST if you want, but it's that's a Reason special.
Right. Well, that is users go the spoilers. So, yeah, so now you've got that kind of, so Polar is giving it that kind of weird softness, funkiness, but with a little bit, like, what I think is kind of cool about the sound is that there's an after bloom now to the sub. It's sort of the attack and, yeah, that, like, it's sort of, it's the opposite of a bounce. It's sort of like a lift to it. It's like it's self side chaining, but that's not really what's happening, but it's sort of the result to that sub. Yeah.
And then after that, I treat it like a sub that I'm juicing up a bit. So we get sausage fattener on here with a pretty high setting, and it starts to bump a little more. And now it kind of feels like it's bursting at the seams a little bit while keeping that kind of buoyancy.
Right.
Then I think, what do we do here? Yeah, this actually, I believe this is my wonderful girlfriend Haley helping me. She is has a lot more mix engineer bona fides than I do, and every now and then we'll hear something and be like, let me clean that up. And this was one where she really helped. As you might hear, there's, like, a little extra boominess in this zone of the song, of the sound, now because of the pitching and all of that. So this just cleans it up a little.
Yeah, surgical, but good.
Wait, I still have it off. Hold on. There we go. Yeah.
Oh, there. Yeah. Less surgical, still good.
Yeah, well, and it evens it out a little bit. Yeah. It's, like, really punching in that lower area. And then this isn't part of the default patch, but in this song in particular, I went to an old, old favorite, another very early rack extension, the soft tube saturation knob.
Classic.
Because there's a lot going on in this chorus, and I just really wanted this bass to cut through and sit on top of everything, and gives it that little fuzz.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, it's so cool. You know what I love about this too is that, and I was just talking with someone earlier this week when I was down in LA. This, you know, we have, music has been just taken over with the various aesthetics of this sort of classification of, like, the 808 kick. And
yeah,
you could have thrown an 808 kick here and done something similar, but it would not work as well as this. And I love that we're in this, there's this new era I feel like we've moved into, which is that everybody is so, we've so done the 808 kick thing, and we all, like, it's got a very useful function in terms of sub and the way bass movement can happen and the sort of the, I don't know, the sustained decay envelope of the 808 kick. Everybody loves it, but people are now coming up with, like, how can I get that, how can I tick all the boxes musically that achieves without it being literally the sound of the 808 kick that we've now been hearing for 12 years or 15 years or something. So,
yeah, I think that's definitely something that I'm always thinking about, because I need songs to have bottom. It's something I'm always frustrated about with vinyl, especially of current music, is just like vinyl doesn't have the, like a certain low amount of frequencies that I've become accustomed to, really like grounding the music I love. It's always something that feels like it needs to be there.
Right.
It's also very fun to try to find ways. I think the two bass instruments I've been using to kind of reinvigorate that have been the one I just showed you, and then another one that starts with trillion, but starts with a trillion acoustic plucked bass patch. Uh-huh.
Oh, so similar, which is like kind of a similar really origin.
Nice, yeah, really right. Nice playable patch, and I think I might Polar it as well, and Sausage Fattener it as well. But
right.
Then it also has this like interesting attack to it that just fully differentiates it from other subs, and then like the tail of it is just like the sub bass note. But having just like an interesting, a different type of bite is really cool.
So yeah, that's a great tip for people watching that. Anyone out there who is, you know, maybe getting a little tired of going to their 808 folder and, you know, using the favorites they've been using for the last while. I mean, I don't know if I would have thought of acoustic basses or sort of acoustic instruments, even classical instruments, as the starting point for an 808. That's not really I think that's a little bit outside the box. But
yeah, but all you really need for an 808 is to be that low. And right. So it's like, what are you gonna take down there?
Right, and
how
adding
how can you get something interesting to bring?
And adding the distortion and you know and sort of the artifacts, if you will, or sort of the algorithmic impart of Polar really does move that out of, you know, nobody would go like, why are you using a, you know, pitch shifted viola on as your 808? It's just not, no one's gonna make that connection. It's just gonna sound interesting. That is cool. You made Matthias, who's the Reason product manager, very happy. He says, I think he's talking about Polar. Still a fantastic device. Always happy when people use it. So there you go.
It's great. It doesn't need much. It does. I haven't probably used even all of its functions. I mostly just use the pitch shifting, but I know it has like other modes that I could still dive into. And
right.
I really enjoy it. So it turns out the piano was another thing I wanted to show here, and it is in the same session. So I'll do the same thing. I'll play it in context and then we can break its origins. So now on its own, it is this lovely guy.
Ooh.
Ooh. So, I love this. I use this piano on all sorts of stuff. There's a lower chords happening in it too here. Actually, no, it's all high.
There's a really interesting like attack thing on that. Like, it's not a tack piano, but it's also not just a regular piano. I guess maybe we'll probably be getting into that.
Yeah, we'll get into that. But so let's see here. As you can see, this is another instance of Polar, but I want to bypass the other stuff so we can hear where it started out. And I'm also going to, there's an echo boy on this on the end, but that's not the most interesting thing going on. But yeah, so on its own, it's probably going to be really high. And I have this on the subdued character, which I've come to really love.
Oh, that thing is so great, isn't
piano.
It? Yeah.
Yeah. I even, and not in this one, but in a recent beat, I realized you can automate this character knob, which can lead to some like truly crazy stuff.
Interesting. Now, but there's usually there's sort of an audible moment before the, yeah. Oh, but it's cool. Oh,
right. Like it's pretty cool. I just feel like in this era of there's a lot of people doing, you know, various like tape warp ways to mess up a piano sample.
Right.
I discovered that and I was like, ooh, like this can do some, this is making some weird artifacts. Like, this is pretty cool.
I love that. That's the kind of thing that I, you know, and I have to, I'm I'm going to mention this because I'm sort of trying to articulate this for anyone else out there that might think like me. I would hear that that it takes, you know, whatever it is, 100 milliseconds to switch from one subdued to other subdued settings. I would just go, oh, well then, okay, I can't do that while audio is going through it because who wants that? And the answer is, we want that. That sounds cool, you know?
Yeah, well, and you're automating it, you know? You're not, like, leaving it up to chance where it's going to go.
Right.
And I think, like, the beats that I've done that in, it's been very much a, like, kind of, like, feeling out what feels good, editing a few of the areas where you're maybe losing it too much. But there can be just, like, really... Anytime, I think you can create a moment where people are like, wait, what am I hearing?
Yes.
Is really exciting. And I think that's a great
way
to do
you're
that.
Getting sort of that, the stutter element of the switch. At the same time, you're getting sort of that, I don't know what you would call it. It's not a four-man shift to the piano, but it's that character shift.
Right, and that's what makes it so cool, is it's not a four-man shift, but it's doing a similar thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Night Shift in the comments says, ooh, gonna borrow that one, ha 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 ha. Yeah.
I love that they built it in. So many VSTs would not let you automate a knob like that. I feel like that would just be like a part of the like patch selection, and that's not a like automation knob parameter.
Exactly.
But it was a really cool discovery when I figured that out. So the other main thing I'm doing in Radical Piano is in the mechanics section, where I have turned all of them up.
And that is the tack quality that I'm hearing in the final sound.
I love it. I love it.
Kind of,
if I take it away, it's so gentle.
You're getting it on the up like, and the down, jump, yeah. Jump.
Yeah.
I mean, it actually sounds in some ways, I'm getting flashbacks to like when I was in school getting my audio tech degree. Like, if you really, really miss mic'd a piano, you did a terrible job of miking a piano, you picked up all the wrong qualities, you know? And it's like that. It's like you're accentuating the things I think that a purist would try and mitigate, and you're doing it for the better. I think it's really bringing in a nice... Yeah, character.
Totally. Then we throw just a Valhalla Vintage Verb on it. I can show the settings briefly, but it's nothing too crazy.
Sure.
It's like a nice long concert hall situation.
Okay. Yeah, just a shimmer.
Just a shimmer that makes it really pretty. And then to me, the real secret sauce is, again, Polar. And in this case, we've got it shifted down an octave on both shifters and panned hard left and right. And this gives it the character that I love.
Wow. That
and
is...
And there's this like softness to it that even when it's up high is still there. And I think in this instance, we can actually quickly look at what this would be like if I just shifted it down 12.
Oh yeah, right, of course.
Playing it in, yeah.
Sounds like a piano, yeah.
Yeah.
And
sounds
do it
like
again?
A normal piano. Yeah, la la la.
Wow.
there's a real different character to
it. Oh, it's so
become,
different.
It's an instrument I use everywhere, and I can just quickly... Like it's
wow. That is
it's an
cool.
instrument that I and you just yeah you get that really nice character I, and I you know I recently I, got Keyscape and I still use this piano.
I'll tell you I don't exaggerate when I say I literally got chills from that. There is a musician, a mentor of mine, that he has this expression that he said to me once that really stuck with me, where he said, "Music is a place." And, you know, you sort of puzzle over that for a second. You do realize that, like, you know, music can take you to a place when done mm-hmm. right. It really, music mm-hmm. is not just a, it's not a sound. It can be a feeling, but music can be a place. And I feel like this is such a classic, like, that piano is a place. Like, that's, when you add that quality to it, and I'm seeing a whole, you know, really it's almost a synesthesia type of imagery
Thank
that
you.
Starts popping up. That is really neat. And I'm not alone in saying that W says, oh my God, this sounds good.
Thank you. Yeah. I mean, and now as you can see, it's saved as a Combinator and I open it up on pretty much everything I work on these
days.
That
is awesome. That is really awesome. Yeah. A couple, another comment, just another person coming to realize Polar is an underrated device. I think I agree. How much you can change sounds if you pull it through Polar. Nice. Yes. Yeah. Hopefully we'll see, we'll start, you know, all of us, and after we're done this live stream, let's all just go into Reason, pop open Polar, and see what we can do with it, because my God.
Yeah, well, and I, as you can hear, like, again, like, when I'm doing this, like, there aren't a lot of pitch shifters where you can throw polyphony at them. Like.
Right.
Like, I'm playing full chords that are going through that and getting fully pitch shifted down.
Absolutely.
And I feel like there aren't a lot of devices that can do that cleanly, like, and not just like you do it and then you transpose it.
Yes.
And I think I love being able to play through that and generate ideas that way.
Yeah. And so the one thing I heard you mention, but I don't know if I fully appreciate it yet, is that you're running each pitch shifter and then you're panning them in stereo to sort of, is it creating a kind of widening effect that's different than if you weren't using both?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a lot like kind of what I did in down, but now doing it in Polar instead of doing it manually. But yeah, let's see. So that's on its own, and if I take this off,
wow,
it's still cool, but
it's still cool, but it's sort of like with the single one, it feels very directional in its placement, you turn that second one on, it kind of becomes all enveloping within the music. Yeah.
Yes, which is again what I always want. And I think I am a very kind of like drums in the center, instruments on the sides type of producer.
Cool.
So it just sets me up without needing to do much more widening or anything to get the piano to the place I want it to be.
Well, that is awesome. That is just super awesome.
I have maybe one more thing I was going to show, but I also know we might be getting up on time and I want to leave time for questions.
Oh, right. Well, yeah, let's say this. Why don't we take a look at that other one and then we can tell people right now, if you have questions for Jeremy, start throwing them into the chat. And if you do, we'll take them, as we wrap up here. But, I think a lot of what I'm seeing in the chat is people that are, taking notes more than throwing questions, because they're learning stuff and stuff they want to try out for sure.
Cool. Yeah, I'm hoping, I think I'm looking for one of the songs where I use Proton on the Rio album, and I think I do in this one, but
okay.
I go back and forth between Proton and the other one. So let's see. It's this one. I want the other one.
Okay.
I want the Reason one. So I know I use it on a different song. Hold on.
Okay.
I love granular stuff.
Yes.
So this is...
Let's see. I'm going to just, while you're doing that, I'll just kind of take a check in with the chat here. Let's see. People still just kind of discussing the last Polar and piano thing. Cougar Town, lovely sounds. Galaxy 20 asks, can we get that patch? I think that might be part of Jeremy's regular toolkit. I don't know if he's I think I'll
it's pretty easy to make.
That's true.
But yeah, I think we're not fully giving it away just yet.
It also to be fair, you know, requires there was Valhalla Verb in there, there was Echo Boy. I mean,
right,
it's not exactly self-contained. Even Polar is not, you know, not necessarily standard. So when we send out patches to people, we try to avoid situations where we're actually just giving people frustration of like, oh, you don't have this, you don't have that. So cool.
I have found what I was looking for.
Excellent.
This is another song from my Clear Eyes album. This one features Rio Cragen. And this is a lot of fun that I had with grain and automating lots of parameters on it, specifically grain length and rate. We get the full thing is this. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I love it. And let's see if we solo it. Yeah, I'm trying to even figure out how to exactly break this down, because so much of it is just what happening with the polar, with the, oh, look, well, we got polar here. Am I even using it yet? But this is another fun way to use polar. Where does it actually come in, though? Where's the, there it is. So we kind of, to that same pattern, I am turning up the shifters. I've got a octave up and a two octaves up, and they're panned to either side.
Oh. Wow. Like a sort of a,
but, it's a
Mad Max riser.
Nice way to, yeah, it's a nice way to kind of enhance some stuff. But yeah, we just, it's really, it's playing some chords.
And now I was seeing the grain. It looks like there's some granular parameters that we're automating there, right?
Yep. The grain length and the grain rate. And I have the grain length going up at the end and the grain rate going down.
Now I'm going to just do a gratuitous zoom in here for a second. If you could play that again, so people can watch that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is cool.
And it really, I did that by, I'm pretty sure, going into this keyboard mapping, getting two faders together, and kind of live playing around with what sounded cool. And then maybe editing it after the fact. But I find that to be a really fun way to get creative with patches like this.
Hmm. That is really neat, yeah. I think for anyone who doesn't mess with their controller knobs, you are sometimes, sometimes when I say these things, I'm kind of admonishing myself, but publicly, so hopefully people can learn from this. You know, I think a lot of times for me, you know, my controllers, one of them sits behind me. The other one is often, if I were to show you on camera, is often underneath various, you know, cables and other things. And so there's a tendency to be like, I'll just draw on the automation. But like, you get a different result when you go to the tactile knob style of automation for things, you know?
Totally. Especially for things like swells. I often, like, another thing that I'll often do is just really wash out a track and then turn the gain all the way down and map the gain to one of my faders, and then just do some rhythmic like pulses and swells and things with it. And you can just get so much more of a like interesting sort of natural feel when you do it that way, especially because it's not like playing pitches where you're really needing to quantize something for it to sound right. Like, you can't really quantize swells in that same way. Right. They are more about rate and pace, and I guess you could quantize where they end, but the swelling of it is a thing that has some room to get creative with the rate of, and I feel like, you know, sometimes it makes sense to draw it in all clean, but other times you're really missing out on an easy opportunity to add some human feel to your track.
Absolutely, absolutely. Cool.
But yeah, that's all I have to show.
I think that is fantastic. And, you know, I'll jump in. There's a couple of comments and questions I'll throw up here for us. One of the things was, wait, let me see here. This is a comment. But the DJ Dark 2019 official says, in every stream, we learn something new. That's why I love watching your streams, the pretty little producer tricks. And yeah, that's why we do them, DJ Dark. And I think that, you know, what's always so interesting is that, you know, Jeremy, you learned to use Reason, but like, nobody taught you these tricks. You know, these are things you came to on your own. And when we have these streams, I think part of what we're doing is we're kind of, it's this collective gathering of, hey, let's all share our tricks. And there's two results in that. One is that we learn your tricks, but then it also causes us to maybe experiment more and come up with our own tricks as well, you know?
I'm a big proponent of, I think one of my early production breakthroughs was when I started just like opening up patches to their default and playing with knobs and stuff.
Right.
And just trying to understand how the literal patch works and a literal plugin works, and not just, you know, I mean, I do a fair amount of, especially when I get a new plugin, I'll go through the presets and find some cool stuff to play. But when you're really getting to know an instrument, it can be really helpful just to try to make a patch on your own and see what it can do. And you start to learn like the kinds of things you find interesting and the kinds of things that can often give you the cool results you want when you just dive in and play around.
And worth, you know, people taking note of the idea that, you know, like you did with the subdued character knob on Radical Piano. It's like, change the parameters, and even if it makes what might at first blush be considered a non-musical result, like, I don't know, I almost like want to just always keep that in my mind, that like, that is like a challenge. Like, oh, really? Does it seem like it's not musical? Well, let me see if I can actually use it in a musical way. And
yeah, I mean, you know, so much of the exciting thing about electronic music is finding those happy mistakes that you can get when you're processing an audio signal in a computer.
Absolutely.
There's so many different weird, crazy sounds you can make.
Absolutely.
It's fun to explore those.
A user by the name, I don't know if I pronounce it Anonymous or Anonymous, oh, wait, where did I just get rid of it? I think I just nuked it. Wait, where did it go? Oh, boy. Well, I tried to put it on screen. I think I deleted it by mistake. He said, I can paraphrase it. He found your use of stereo and panning, so many different sort of panning tricks. A lot of these things you're doing are related to the stereo field, and he found that very interesting. I think that's true. You seem to be hyper aware of stereo placement and the overall stereo presentation of your tracks.
Definitely. Yeah, I think it's just inextricable for me from how I hear the music. And it's always been when you're trying to make sure every instrument has its own space and can be heard, it's one of the biggest tools you have to give it that. So much in your mix can open up when you pan things out and give the middle room to breathe.
On a technical level, if I can sort of talk to you on the kind of pro delivery side of things, do you find, or did you find maybe early on, that you had to be aware on both sides of all those widening tricks that you're doing, but then also sort of staying mindful of the boring thing, which is mono compatibility, which is something that you obviously, especially if you're talking about syncs, but also people listening on devices like their Alexas and stuff, you know, mono compatibility does raise its head. Has that ever been an issue for you, or something you just have to keep in mind?
I honestly should probably test for it more, but it's never really been something I think too much about. I think a lot of the time I'm doing stuff that is more just panning, and it's pretty rare that I fully do like one of the more phasey type of widening effects.
Right.
I try to be more conscious when I'm using those. But yeah, I don't know. I don't think about it too much.
Nothing. Well, that's good though. But that's, I mean, that in and of itself, I think, is a good thing for people to hear, because, you know, I think there are people that can be. I've known people to be a little extra sensitive to phase in ways they don't need to necessarily be that worked up about it. I will, you know, a lot of the sound designers who do sort of like Reese bass and 808 bass sound design stuff, they get so in their heads about, you know, the phase alignment of all the elements they're doing, and there are times where I'm going, is that as big a deal as you're making it? All right, you know. David says he's going to rewatch this stream because there's so many tips and tricks. David, please do rewatch this stream and everyone else. That's why we make them replayable. And let me just see here. There's Eric has a technical question about Mimic. I think he's asking that of Matthias, our Reason product manager, who's in the chat. So that's not going to throw that your way. But I will say you are with Reason 12. Mimic has sort of like what we're looking at here, where you're doing this stuff with grain. You that might be done now. A days in Mimic, are you a fairly?
I would say this effect is probably one of the things that I would probably still go to grain for, just to have the visualization of this part of it and the flexibility to automate things. But yeah, as I was telling you, I love Mimic. I love being, you know, as you saw in the down session in the past, I was doing a lot of chopping things up in Recycle and then loading them up in a Rex player, and now to just be able to drag something into Mimic and adjust the sensitivity and edit the chops to make it exactly how I like, but all within the Reason session, and then just be able to play it is very exciting and something I'm really excited to keep playing with and will be all over my future music.
Cool. Well, listen, Jeremy, I have enjoyed having you so much. And like I said to you yesterday when we were setting up this tech, this is, I feel like a long time coming for you and I to connect because I've been a fan and aware of your music. You know, you did some early, when Down first came out, you were doing some like track walkthroughs and some other videos on other channels and stuff. And we'd see that stuff. We'd go, oh my God, hey, I know that.
There's Reason.
There's Reason, you know? I know that rack. Yeah. So that was...
Yeah. No, yeah, it's been Reason for me since day one. I'm very grateful. As I told you, you added audio just when I needed it, and you added VSTs just when I needed it.
Yeah.
Both were cases where I was maybe about to leave, and I am still here doing everything in Reason, and I love it.
Awesome. That is awesome. I'm going to throw, there's one late straggler comment coming out here. I think we kind of might have touched on it, but maybe there's something more to ask. Galaxy 20 asks, what devices do you use to be the most creative?
Oh, man, I would say Mimic is one of them, and maybe use this opportunity to share one of my favorite tricks with Mimic when I am feeling a little more blocked, which is to sample myself whenever I'm home or I'm in any studio with like a real piano, I'll just like press record and just like improvise for a bit, and then, but I can also do it at home just like with the piano patch I was showing you guys earlier. Just improvise for a bit, play around, and then load that up in Mimic, pitch it around, start chopping it separately, and see what comes of it. But I've always found the sampling process to be a great place to go when sitting and thinking of melodies is not the thing that is firing in my brain at that moment.
Gotcha. Cool. Well, listen, the chat thanks you. I thank you, of course. Reason Studios thanks you.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
We are thrilled to have you and hope to have you again and you know, do more and dream more projects together. We can probably do some cool stuff, I'm sure. So
definitely.
This is a goodbye for now, but not a goodbye permanently. So cool. Well, Jeremy, thanks so much. I'm going to...
thank you, guys.
You hang around. I'll see you on the other side of this stream after I wrap up here and say a personal goodbye with you. But for now, folks... It's up to me to say goodbye to you guys. So it does it for us today. We are back, I think, in 2 weeks. You guys might know the schedule better than even I do. But I think we have Raheem in about 2 weeks' time here on the Reason Livestream. And until then, you've got a ton of stuff to try out just from this stream alone. Polar, my God, so much stuff there. Grain, that last trick. Sample yourself playing piano, chop it up and juggle it in grain. Don't go looking for samples. Be the sample. So, guys, have a blast. Make a lot of music. I hope you're as inspired as I am. And I'll see you next time on the Reason Livestream.